अस्मत् गुरुभ्यो नमः। ज्ञानानंदमयं देवं निर्मलस्फटिकाकृतिं आधारं सर्वविद्यानां हयग्रीवं उपास्महे। सत्यज्ञानसुखस्वरूपं अमलं क्षीराब्धिमध्यस्थितं स्वाङ्कारूढरमाप्रसन्नवदनं भूषासहस्रोज्ज्वलं त्र्यक्षं पिनाकभयकरान् बिभ्रान्नाच्छच्छविं छत्रीभूतं फणीन्द्रबिन्दुदवडं लक्ष्मीन्द्रसिंहं भजे। नमस्ते। Welcome to the Natyamrita Manthan. In this online web series focusing on name, place, animal and thing, I'll be using some of my paintings to stress the Vatsalya Rupa of Narasimha. Vatsa means a child. I try to focus on the element of Vatsalya in Narasimha. Everyone is afraid of Narasimha. We have been taught to love God, not fear Him. But in the case of Narasimha, it was a difficult image to portray. I thought, if a dialogue on this seemingly fearsome deity could be had through visuals, maybe it could make a difference in perception. Maybe it could show His gentler side. Maybe the approach could be more subtle. I began to study the various styles of Narasimha from the sculptures in temples, bronzes, murals and many other paintings done in the Pahari style, Pattachitra style, etc. Some of the Mewari sculptures in the Nepali style took my breath away, particularly the pictures of Hiranyavada were magnificent. I observed many different perspectives and narratives using different styles from the iconography of Narasimha. In fact, there are some unwritten rules followed by tradition that Sri Narasimha should not be portrayed without Lakshmi or Prahlada. So my readings on the Avatara began during early 2001. I was inspired reading about Narasimha in Srimad Bhagavatam, Srimad Narayaniyam, Vishnu Puranam and some classic compositions of Shankara Bhagavatpada, Swami Deshika, Arvas and the others. This painting which you see here is Sri Narasimha with Prahlada, not exactly a study in iconography, but I try to represent him as a Shanta Swarupi, retaining the dramatic element. He is shown here holding Prahlada, seated on his Garuda Vahana. The idea was to retain the aesthetic and traditional aspects of art, but show the subject in a new light. A different medium like papyrus was used to make it look fresh. Since it was a papyrus, the style used was Egyptian. This is Hiranyavadam in the Kerala mural style, where they adopt the Panchavarnam. We have been brought up under the notion of Narasimha, always in a frightening form, the Ugra Narasimha, with angry looks and the violent Hiranyavada, where he tears up Hiranya with his sharp nails and wears his intestines as a garland. It has been magnificently portrayed in sculptures, murals and paintings. It's awesome, but it does frighten one. In this work of Hiranyavada, I chose to show him with his Attahasam, the loud laughter, and make the garland of intestine look like a string of lotuses to soften the mood. A kind of lovable Narasimha. Well, it's a paradox. This unpredictable man-lion form was assumed by Vishnu to satisfy the conditions of Hiranyakashipu's boon. He also had to match the power and mighty persona of Hiranyakashipu to warn him that his devotees cannot be harmed in any way. his avatara was meant to show his commitment to his devotees, Ashrita Vatsalya, to protect those who surrender to him, and also a terror to those who are wicked to his bhaktas. You can see him holding Hiranya's head in his hands along with Prahlada here on his lap. Narasimha was a combination of love for the bhakta and simaswapnam for the person who harms his bhakta. This is a adaptation from Swami Deshika's Kamasikashtakam, where he mentions Satapatala Bhishani Sarabasattahasodbhate Spurat Kriti Parispurat Mukuti Kepi Paktre Krite Kripakapata Kesarin Dhanajatimba Dattastana Saroja Sadrusha Vyati Vishajjate Vyajjate. This is Sri Nagamanta Deshika. Here he, Narasimha is described as having a fearful mien. His eyes and brows show a sort of fury. Satapatale Bhishani, but with a completely different countenance, as that of a mother suckling her baby. Dhanujadimba Dattastana. He is a Kapata Kesari. This was a challenging one, as the expressions should convey both terror and compassion at the same time. This is Sri Mantrarajapada Stotra, which is a commentary of each padam of the Narasimha Mola Mantra by Sri Shankara, Ugram Viram Mahavishnum, etc. It is so detailed and it conveys the Rupa of Narasimha in its entirety, a Vishwarupa as it were. I have shown Sri Narasimha here in Shankara's very own form of Sri Nataraja. Here Vishnu is in Vaikuntha in the form of Narasimha with Sri Lakshmi. This is again inspired from the Mantrarajapada Stotra, where he is described having Mahasatam Mahadamshtram Tamrasimham Namamyaham, majestic mane, Mahadamshtram, sharp big teeth and looking majestic. This is Vishnu and his garland of devotees. For Vishnu, the Bhakta is supreme. He tells Durvasa in Ambarisha Charita, Aham Bhakta Paradhinaham. Prahlada is the foremost of his devotees. Daityanam Prahladaschasmi in the Gita. His avatara was to reassure his devotees about his guarantee in the Gita, Name Bhakta Pranashyati. My devotee does not come to ruin. Here, his ornamentation is the string of bhaktas. You can see at the center, you can see Narada, who is the guru for both Dhruva and Prahlada here. This is Lakshmi. These are the gopikas who are at the height of, in the top of the hierarchy in bhakti. And these are the four parrots representing the Vedas. This is Gajendra. This is Dhruva. This is Garuda. This is Hanuman, and this is the cow from the Krishna Avatara. So you can see the only ornaments he has here are the devotees and Adisesha here. Prahlada is always an ideal of bhakti. In fact, Vishnu Purana says he was the seed of bhakti. A doubt may arise, why so much anger and the need to kill? There are three gunas, sattva, rajas and tamas. The interplay of these gunas cause all the inequilibrium and turmoil on earth. Being the supreme, he is beyond these gunas. enmity towards anyone does not arise, nor does he need to kill anyone to prove his authority. In circumstances where some undesirable elements have to be killed to save his devotee, paritranaya sadhunam, or safeguard dharma, dharma samsthapanarthaya, he uses his yogamaya and assumes those gunas. In this picture, Sambhavami Yuge Yuge, you can see Krishna vanquishing power, pouring, in fact spitting cold water on the arrogance of the mighty. From the Matsyavatara onwards, so you can see the Matsyavatara here, up to the end of the Dashavatara, here this is Krishna. So this covers an entire gamut of avatars. Narasimha avatara was a specific and shortest avatara only to prove his ashrita vatsalya, protection to those who surrender to him. Now let's recount the story of Prahlada. This is a narrative of the story in the Egyptian style. This was done in 2008. It all starts with the four divine sages, the Purna Jnanis, Sanaka, Sanandana, Sanatana and Sanat Kumara, who visit Vaikuntha to pay their obeisance to Sriman Narayana. The Dwarapalakas Jaya and Vijaya stop them. The sages get angry and curse the two Dwarapalakas. This is Vaikuntha, where there is no presence of Rajo and Tamo Gunas. You don't deserve to be here. You will soon be born as Asuras on earth. This is just God's will being put into action. They were given three births on earth, after which they will return to Vaikuntha. Jaya and Vijaya fall to earth. Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu are the first births of Jaya and Vijaya. Second is Ravana and Kumbhakarna in the Ramavatara, and the third Sishupala and Dantavakra in Krishnavatara. They command absolute power, the power of the brawn. They torment people. Hiranyaksha, brimming with arrogance of power, looks for a fight. He couldn't find any opponent. He immersed the earth in water and roamed about, rolling his mighty mace. Vishnu appears as Varaha to retrieve the earth from the water. He rescues the earth and playfully kills Hiranyaksha after giving the fight he wanted. Varaha even appreciates the skills of his opponent during the fight. Hiranyakashipu was watching this. Hiranyakashipu was Hiranyaksha's brother. He was consumed by grief and anger over his younger brother's death. He swore in the royal assembly to kill Vishnu. He incites the people to destroy all dharmic education, make life miserable for Vishnu Bhaktas, destroy yajnas and other rituals, which is the strength of Vishnu. After the last rites of Hiranyaksha, he consoles the sons of Hiranyaksha and his wife Rishabhanu with honey-like words steeped in dharma shastras. He tells them how the soul is imperishable, how one's own accumulated karma was the cause for the suffering, etc. He quotes stories from the Puranas to mitigate their sorrow. Yes, Hiranyakashipu was learned indeed. But his vow to kill Vishnu was strong. To that end, he wants to make himself more powerful. Here is shown flexing his arms. He wanted to make himself more powerful without any rivals, unconquerable, with eternal youth, and the unparalleled emperor of all three worlds. He leaves for the Mantara mountain to perform severe austerities. Hiranyakashipu was engaged in austerities. His wife Kayadu is pregnant with Prahlada, the youngest of his four sons. Indra tries to kill the child in the womb, fearing more trouble. But Narada appears and tells Indra that the child has the qualities of a Deva. He will be a devotee of the Lord. He will establish the grammar for bhakti for all time. While Kayadu is asleep, Narada narrates the great qualities of Vishnu and instills in him the devotion to Hari. That was Narada's Upadesha to Prahlada, Hari. Hiranyakashipu continues his severe and glorious penance. The Devas are disturbed. They inform Brahma about his ulterior motives and ask him to stop the penance. Brahma goes to the cave where Hiranya was in deep penance. He finds Hiranyakashipu covered with an anthill and stripped to the skeleton by the elements and insects. Brahma sprinkles sacred water from his kamandalu. Hiranyakashipu becomes his royal glowing self and prostrates before Brahma. Brahma praises the son of Diti and offers him a boon. Hiranyakashipu seeks immortality. Brahma says it is impossible. Hiranyakashipu alters his wish with a well-thought-out boon, adding various clauses and equations thrown in, a boon just short of immortality. My death will not be caused by any of your creations, neither inside nor outside, neither by any weapon made by you nor by any others, not by any poisonous creatures, neither on earth nor in the sky, neither by animal nor by man, neither by lifeless objects nor with those with life, neither by the Devas nor Asuras. I also seek to be the only leader of all embodied souls with all honor and respect which you command. Also, please grant me imperishable wealth and prosperity. Brahma says, my child, this sort of boon has never been given earlier to anyone and the most difficult to get. I grant it to you. He leaves for Brahmaloka. Empowered by the boon, Hiranyakashipu's enmity with Vishnu multiplies manifold. He returns to his empire with a tejas the people had never seen before. He conquers the three worlds, the four quarters, to his already vast empire, adds the treasures of the heavens and the subservience of the gods led by Indra. He enjoys immortal health, wealth and fame. Well, almost. Prahlada was sent to study under the Asura Guru Shukracharya's sons Chanda and Amarta. They were instructed to teach Prahlada and other Asura children that Hiranyakashipu was the lord of the world and all prayers and rituals be directed at him alone. Prahlada rejected their teachings but pretended to learn everything that they taught. Once Hiranyakashipu took Prahlada on his lap and asked him what was the essence of his learning. Prahlada answered, dear father, I am glad you asked me that. The I and mine delusions are the causes for the downfall of the Atma, our soul. The only solution is to take refuge in the feet of Hari and attain salvation, moksha. Hiranyakashipu was angry but manages to laugh. He is just a child of five. Maybe his teachers may not have taught him well. He calls the teachers and reprimands them and asks them to keep Prahlada from being influenced by Vishnu Bhaktas. On the other hand, Prahlada was the one who was teaching the disciples when the teachers were away. Again, when Hiranyakashipu asks the same question, Prahlada tells his father about Navada Bhakti. At another time, he praises Narayana and his devotees. And yet another time, he asks his father to tear away from this world and set his mind on Hari. This cycle continued until Hiranyakashipu's anger becomes uncontrollable. The ego wins. He also learns that the students in the ashram were now influenced by Prahlada's teaching. He orders his men, "He is none other than my enemy. I don't have any consideration that he is my son. Put him to death." Now, there were so many attempts in various cruel ways to kill Prahlada. But every time, Prahlada is miraculously saved. You can see him thrown from a cliff here, again trampled upon by elephants, then put him among the snakes, they tie him and throw him into a river, and every time he escapes as Hari was with him. It was his conviction that Hari was with him which saves him from sure death. Hiranyakashipu summons Prahlada. "The Hari, as you say, where is he? Can you show him to me?" "Yes," says Prahlada. It was a sort of hide and seek, where Prahlada could see Hari everywhere and Hiranyakashipu couldn't see him anywhere. "Are kwasau kwasau sakala jagatatma haririti?" "Is the one you call Hari in this pillar?" he asks. "Then why is he not visible? Kasmat stambena drishyate?" It seems at that time Vishnu was ready in everything, everyone, everywhere to show himself and prove Prahlada's Mahavishwasa true. Deshika says everything on earth became a Narasimha Garbha. Hiranyakashipu hits the pillar with his fist. Vishnu emerges from the pillar, assuming a man-lion form, majestic and roaring with laughter, splitting the ears of Hiranyakashipu, and the entire Brahmanda trembles. His countenance was that of a moon, a huge white form, sharp hairs bristling. The fiery eyes were of molten gold, rolling all the time. His shaking manes covered the whole sky. His huge wide-open mouth was terrifying with a pair of molars revealed. A quivering sword stuck out like tongue rolled out. This is Bhattadri's description of Sriman Narayaniyan. This dramatic and majestic appearance was a poet's delight. Narasimha hits the pillar, revealing Narasimha as a split-second sculpture. This is a sketch which I did sometime in 2002. And here is another drawing which treats the subject in a philosophical way. Narasimha sculpts away the stone form of Hiranyakashipu to reveal Prahlada. So this is Hiranyakashipu driven away, and this is Prahlada being revealed. Now let's see the whole narrative in the earlier painting of Narasimha and Prahlada in the Egyptian style. Narasimha is white in color. He is shown with 1,000 hands. He is knocking on the doors of Hiranyakashipu's heart, but the ego doesn't allow him in. The veil of Maya over his face, suggested by the pearl strings, hides Narasimha from him. After the Hiranyavada, this is Lakshmi and Prahlada watch the grand spectacle, and after the Hiranyavada, everyone is afraid to approach Narasimha. The gods, led by Brahma, who are watching this, send Prahlada first. Narasimha's anger subsides immediately. Prahlada fearlessly walks to Narasimha, who lifts the child onto his lap. He is pleased, absolutely pleased. Now, what Narasimha is a lion. What does a lion do to its cub? It keeps licking it. Narasimha shows his love for his devotee by licking the child. This was described by Shri Keshav Narayan Dongri Maharaj in his Pravachans on the Bhagavata Rahasya. This one image changed my perception of Sri Narasimha. Again, the same image from the Bhagavata series 2007, and this one recently done, inspired by Chinese sculpture. After this, Prahlada extols Narasimha, the Prahlada Stuti in Srimad Bhagavata, one of the most beautiful praises of Sri Narasimha. He expresses his gratitude and considers himself uniquely blessed by the gentle act of Narasimha placing his palm on his tiny head. This blessing of Karasparsha was not given to anyone, not to Shiva or even Shri. Na brahmano na tu bhavasya na me ramaya yanmer pita shirasi padmakara prasadaha. This is Prahlada Stuti. A pleasant Narasimha speaks to Prahlada. Bhadram te asurottama varam ranishva. Ask me any boon, I shall grant it to you. Prahlada's reply to Narasimha was stern. He says, we don't want and neither do we expect anything in return to love our Lord. Do you think we are businessmen? Savai Vanik, he says. Lakshmi Narasimha laughs. This is exactly what I expect from my devotee. After accepting praises from the gods and warning Brahma to be more careful while giving boons, Narasimha vanished. Srimad Bhagavatam. Now this is an image of Bala Narasimha, a painting where the Lord and his devotee are constant companions. Prahlada's companion all through his tribulations was Narasimha. It is said that when he was thrown from a mountain cliff, Prahlada put both hands on his chest as if to protect Vishnu, lest his hari inside his heart should be put to any discomfort. Such was Prahlada's bhakti, which is described as avichinna taila dharavat, like the unbroken flow of oil. These pictures of Ahobilam Lakshmi Narasimha deities, Narasimha is always joyous when he is with Lakshmi. Lakshmiya samalingita vama bhagam Lakshmi Narasimham sharanam prapadye. It is such a beautiful deity, just about a few inches in height. The details are amazing. Malola Narasimha, as he is called, as a full-mouthed laugh where even the depths of the throat is visible in such a tiny sculpture. Absolutely delicate work, a delight to watch. One can also see Lakshmi's right hand hugging Narasimha from behind. It is the Utsava deity of Sri Ahobhila Math. In fact, Swami Deshika in his Sri Stuti says, the avatara was to show his magnificent form, Adbhuta Kesari, to please Mahalakshmi. These are other forms of the same deity, Lakshmi Narasimha. Now we come to Tirukoshtiyur. The boon of Hiranyakashipu was complicated, a riddle, difficult to satisfy. The Sthala Purana of Tirukoshtiyur near Karaikudi says it was at this place that the three murtis, Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva, had a discussion on the ways to kill Hiranyakashipu without violating any clause of his boon. Goshti is a group, hence called Goshtiyur, Tirukoshtiyur. When Narasimha appeared out of the pillar, he was like a child screaming with joy of having solved the puzzle. The glee and ecstasy when you crack a code. These are direct sketches. Of the two Narasimha sculptures in Tirukoshtiyur at the eastern entrance, it is a sort of animation in two panels on either side of the doorway. The left panel shows Narasimha pinning down Hiranyakashipu. With multiple wrestling holds that he cannot move. The second panel to the right is the Vadam. You can see the continuity in both panels. Where the movement of the holds have been maintained as a follow-through. There is one more detailing to this, which is of interest to artists and dancers alike. The way he puts on the garland of intestines. A graceful move of the hands, which lifts his two fingers and turns and reverses the direction of the hands upside down, making it easier to wear the garland too. A marvel of sculpture in stone. This popular story of Narasimha Avatara is from the Srimad Bhagavatam. Now, let us have a look at what Vishnu Purana says. Vishnu Purana, composed by sage Parashara, is a Sattvic Purana. Here, the same story is mentioned up to the time of Prahlada's miraculous escapes from the death on Hiranyakashipu's orders. But Hiranyakashipu is not killed. Prahlada appeals to Hari and Hari appears. He acknowledges the complete faith and the unparalleled bhakti of Prahlada and asks him and grants him a boon. Prahlada doesn't want anything for himself, but seeks Hari to change the attitude of Hiranyakashipu towards the Supreme. Hari smiles and grants the wish. Hiranyaksha is reformed and both continue to live. Prahlada is later crowned as emperor. Now let's have a look into the idea of Narasimha, Hiranyakashipu and Prahlada. The literal meaning of Hiranyakashipu is a golden pillow or bolster. The Jivatma, who is enjoying all pleasures in life, and slowly that golden pillow of pleasures makes one forget the Almighty and the purpose of their birth. He loses focus and sinks in Maya only to keep swimming in the sea of birth and death. He takes the joys of life for granted and identifies himself with his body. we can sum it up as ignorance. Prahlada represents an ideal bhakta. The word halada means joy, ananda. He is the reason for the avatara. He is tuned to the ways of Hari from childhood. Prahlada says in his Stuti to Narasimha, Kaumarat acharet prajnaha. The wise train themselves to focus on jnana from a very young age. He is not affected seeing his father killed before him. In fact, his mind is so clear, he uses the occasion to sing praises of Narasimha. Narasimha is the ray of light. The moment he appears, darkness vanishes. He dispels ignorance and assures the sadhus of protection, paritranaya sadhunam, and also warns those who harm the sadhus, vinashaya cha dushkritam. There are so many aspects of Narasimha, but within the time limit, I hope I have done justice to the subject. Anything good, I owe it to the gurus. Faults or inconsistencies are all mine. Thanks for the patient hearing. I thank Dr. Lakshmi Ramaswamy of Mudralaya and the organizers of this lecture series who gave me this wonderful opportunity. Namaste. स्वभावात् करोमि तत् सर्वं परस्परं जीवन्मः.